Record. Okay, so this part's going to record. Let's click on the right key here. And one more key. And there we go. So this slideshow is available at tiny.cc/RRRadio. So radio. And there's a lot of links in it as usual. Just as most of my slideshows, there is a ton of links in it. And the links can be found by seeing the little link icon or looking for the serif fonts. So these, for example, bring you back to biographies on these two early pioneers of radio. Maxwell didn't actually work with radios, but he worked with all the formulas involved in electromagnetism. And he was a math guy, and he predicted the existence of electromagnetic radio waves and their propagation through space in 1861 to 1873, so long before radios came out. Heinrich Hertz in 1886 is actually the first person to transmit and receive controlled radio waves. And he used a little device right here. We'll show a video of it.
Electromagnetic waves. The great scientist, Heinrich Hertz, was the first man to transmit and detect electromagnetic waves. In his famous experiment, a high voltage current was applied to the two ends of two metal wires, which generated a spark in the gap between them. This spark resulted in the radiation of electromagnetic waves. Those electromagnetic waves traveled through the air and created a spark in a metal coil located over a meter away. If you had placed an LED in that gap, the bulb would have glowed. This was a clear case of electromagnetic wave propagation and detection. However, before Hertz, the brilliant mathematician James Clerk Maxwell had already laid out the foundations for electromagnetic radiation by formulating four mathematical equations.
And if he would have been able to put that LED in there, it would have saved us a lot of trouble with tubes. We could have jumped right to the solid state area. Marconi is often thought of as one of the fathers of radio, and he basically proved that electromagnetic energy could be put into a practical use, the transmission of information with radio waves. And the information he was transmitting was basically Morse code. By having the keying on and off, he was able to send Morse code with radio waves. He also then used them to send them for long distances. So basically what Marconi ushered in was the era of wireless-based telegraphy. And here's a video that you can watch. I'm not going to play all these videos, but this is a video on Marconi that you can watch. And it's a really good series that this person put together on famous scientists and biographies for kids. Fleming is the inventor of the two-electrode radio rectifier, which was called the thermionic valve, also known as the vacuum diode, Kentron, thermotronic tube, and the Fleming valve. Patented in 1904, it was the first electronic rectifier of radio waves, converting alternating radio current signals into weak direct currents detectable by a telephone receiver. So he's the first one that was able to do this with the first tube. And there's a video on Fleming that I'm not going to play today. I'm expecting you all to do your homework and go through all these videos on your own later.
Plugged into her Chromebook.
Reginald Fessenden is a Canadian, and he teamed up with General Electric engineer Alexanderson to develop an alternator that produced a continuous wave that could transmit sound. And basically, by doing this, he was the first one to not use the simple switching on and off of Morse code. He figured out that you could actually transmit sound waves. And this is the principle of amplitude modulation. December 24th, 1906, he supposedly, and there's questions about whether this actually happened or not, broadcast a Christmas Eve program playing a violin, a phonograph recording of Handel's Largo, and wishing everyone a Merry Christmas and doing a reading from the Bible. I'm going to play a little bit of this video on him.
In 1899, a temperamental Canadian scientist had a vision of sending music and speech over the wireless. It took him 7 years, but in November of 1906, he sent a wireless signal over 10 miles where the sound was perfect. Ready for how radio began? Let's go.
Electricity, 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 electricity.
Wireless telephone. At the time, the system to create radio waves was called a spark gap generator, and it would create a pulse of radio waves and a spark a number of times every second, usually around 20 to 50. Fessenden's friend made a blueprint for a new spark gap generator that would produce about 10,000 sparks every second. So it basically made continuous, although uneven, radio waves. By 1900, it was complete. And Fessenden attached a microphone to the transmitter so that when a person talked into the microphone, it compressed or extended the carbon fibers in it to change the resistance and thus the amplitude or strength of the current. Because the system modulated the amplitude, it was eventually called AM radio for amplitude modulation. He managed to send a signal over a mile. However, to him, it created an, quote, extremely loud and disagreeable noise due to the irregularity of the spark.
One, two, three, four.
In 1904, Fessenden joined with General Electric, no Edison anymore, to create smooth continuous radio waves vibrating at about 100,000 times a second. The idea was to create AC current the same way a generator does, by spinning wires near electromagnets, but spin it ridiculously fast and have as many magnets as possible. Instead of having complicated coils, they created a solid metal disc with radial slots in it, filled with non-conducting, non-magnetic material. They hired a 26-year-old wonder kid named Ernst Alexanderson to work full-time on the project. And 2 years later, in 1906, they finally succeeded. For a time, the Alexanderson alternator was the finest radio producer.
And this is one of the devices that's typically used on Christmas Eve. They bring it back out of use each year in Sweden to be able to send signals with it. But they're not doing it this year.
In the world. However, the final alternator was huge, too heavy to put on a boat, and very expensive and hard to operate. In the meantime, Fessenden also created a better receiver to make radio waves audible, called an electrolytic detector. See, if you have an antenna, you can catch radio waves. If you add a capacitor, or also called a condenser, which is just an object that has two conductive sides with a thin insulator between them, then the capacitor can collect charges on its surfaces. If the capacitor then discharges through a coil, it will create a changing current and a changing magnetic field in a coil, which creates more current in the coil, which then charges the capacitor in the other direction, which then discharges the other way. What I'm trying to say here is if you have a capacitor in a coil, it'll tend to oscillate at a certain frequency. This is called a tank circuit and is the backbone of all radio. Therefore, if you have an antenna with a coil and a capacitor, then you can tune your coil so that it vibrates at the same frequency as the incoming wave. However, if you place that signal in a speaker, it would oscillate way too fast for a human to hear. What Fessenden needed was a one-way valve or a rectifier. If you then listen to the signal on headphones, the headphones would only respond to the envelope or the uneven amplitude of the signal. So the big question is, how do you make a one-way electrical valve? Fessenden made his best one in 1903. Fessenden's detector, which was really just a one-way valve, had a thin piece of platinum in a cup of acid that was connected to a battery with a variable resistor. The resistor would then be adjusted to give a tiny bit of voltage across the detector, which would create a reaction between the acid and the metal, and would create an insulating bubble around the metal. If a separate voltage was placed in the same direction, then the bubble would increase in size and no current could flow. If the voltage was in the opposite direction, then the bubble would decrease and current could flow. Voila, a one-way valve. For a few years, this detector was the most popular radio detector around. So now Fessenden had a way of making smooth continuous radio waves, a way of adding sound to it with a microphone, and a way of receiving it with his receptor. It was time to build a giant radio tower and send the first true AM radio signal. On December 10, 1906, they sent out invitations to local scientists and newspaper people to witness history. Wireless transmission of sound over 10 miles. They spoke and played records and even surprised a fisherman on a boat who was expecting the beeps of Morse code, not audible speech. Fessenden later claimed that he created a whole musical section for the enjoyment of people on a boat on Christmas Eve 1906. But there's much contention about whether that actually happened or not. Even if it did, however, Fessenden wasn't thinking about broadcasting radio signals. He was thinking about making wireless telephone. Also, Fessenden began to fight with his co-workers.
And that's one of the key things. Almost all these commercial projects in the beginning, the idea was not to broadcast. It was be able to do one-way or single messaging between individual parties. Basically, a way of having a wireless telephone. So these are some of the things he did that they talk about in the video. And here's a reproduction of a recreation of a possible what the Christmas Eve broadcast would have sounded like.
Calling CQ to all ships. This is station BO. Bravo Ocean. Listen, you are about to hear a special transmission for Christmas Eve.
That was a phonograph recording of Handel's Largo. We will now have a solo sung by one of our engineers, Mr. Stein, accompanied by me on the violin. I must apologize, as it appears that Mr. Stein will be unable to perform for us this evening, so those of you who are listening to this transmission will have to be content with a violin solo by Reginald Fessenden.
I also have a link here for a variety of radio programs over the years that were done as in the Christmas season, and you can explore that later. And here's a video on another video on Fessenden.
In 1899,
Leedy Forrest is credited with the invention of the first audion tube based on the Fleming tube, which you saw earlier. But there's a lot of controversy as to whether he actually did what he said he did. But the whole idea was these tubes, whether he created them or Fleming's tube, was to replace the earlier coherer, which was the device that was used for receivers. It was basically a device that basically closed and opened a switch when it received signals. So it was only really useful for Morse code. It wasn't good for audio. So the tubes were very necessary in that process. So Leedy Forrest claimed that he was the man that created radio, but when you watch the video, you'll find out a lot of that is false. Edward Howard Armstrong, one of DeForest's major rivals, is considered the father of FM. He invented the regenerative circuit that was used in many of the receivers, both AM and FM, and also the superheterodyne circuit, which was vastly improved radio. He offered a series of experimental broadcasts, and it was Armstrong's idea to begin using a speaker to listen to the radio as opposed to headsets. Sarnoff, during this period, saw radio as a curious experiment. He saw radio's commercial potential, the possibility of radio music boxes in every home, where they would be basically sending the information. Very similar to what we talk about smart speakers today, where people are streaming audio in their house. He saw it as an appliance, little more than talking furniture. The main revenue will be derived from the sale of the radio music boxes, not the radio surface itself, which eventually was the main profit. And here's a video on Sarnoff and Armstrong. So early uses of radio, The main use of radio was a replacement for wire-based telegraphy. The use of dots and dashes and Morse code allowed operators to send letters and words via radio so they could send messages. Early technology could not handle such as speech or music well. As technology grew, it became possible to easily and effectively send voice and music also. So the early uses of radio, the number one use is when you were unable to string wires to send telegraphy or phone messages. And those meant that it was very important for messages between ships and between ships and shore. It was useful across the oceans, and it was the only viable way to communicate from an airplane to ground. Because, of course, you couldn't drag the wires around with you. The second use, earlier use of radio, was experimental. It was a scientific curiosity, and a lot of people were studying not only the effects of radio for communication, but also the effects on health and other effects on life forms. Most early companies were interested in the commercial use of radio to replace private telegraphy messaging, not broadcasting. This, by the way, is the University of Michigan Radio Club in the 1900s. The fourth use mainly was tinkers, what we know today as amateur radio operators. By 1910, there were thousands of amateur operators on the air across the world. In 1917, however, the advent of World War I brought an immediate end to what had became amateur radio until after the war. This is a typical amateur radio station of 1920. Of great interest in wartime usage, radio was first used by the Japanese Navy in the Soviet-Japanese War in 1905. In World War I, the U.S. Navy was put in charge of regulating radio usage in the United States. And here's some pictures of radio during wartime. It was very interesting. A lot of the Army groups put women in charge of radio communications back at the main bases, not at the front lines, but at the main bases. So there were a lot of women operators of radio. The first commercial station, we're going to play a little video here.
65 years ago, it was mostly a dream. Today, broadcasting is such an important part of our way of life, it is hard to imagine life without it. The world's first scheduled broadcast was made from Westinghouse's KDKA, Pittsburgh, the pioneer broadcasting station of the world.
November 2nd, 1985. November 2nd, 1970. November 2nd, 1960. November 2nd, 1950. November 2nd, 1940. November 2nd, 1930.
The time, November 2nd, 1920. The place, an industrial area of East Pittsburgh. Rain is falling gently in the darkness. Just ahead, two young men are walking quickly toward one of the entrances of a large factory building. They enter and hurry up the long stairway to join three others in a tiny makeshift shack on the roof. A shack filled with electrical equipment. Each takes their place in the room. William Thomas is at a large panel of switches. R.S. McClelland and John Frazier sit at telephones. Chief Engineer Little stands by. And seated in front of a small box is Leo H. Rosenberg. William Thomas checks his pocket watch, nods, and throws a switch. And Leo Rosenberg begins the world's first scheduled broadcast.
This is KDKA
of the Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company in East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
But did Leo Rosenberg realize he was making history?
Everybody asked me that, and we had no idea because there never had been any broadcasting. As a matter of fact, there was no such word as broadcast at that time. What we did was to send out the electric return.
But the man responsible for the Westinghouse engineering triumph wasn't present at that first broadcast. Dr. Frank Conrad, assistant chief engineer of Westinghouse, was standing by at his experimental radio station, 8XK, 5 miles away in Wilkinsburg, in case the East Pittsburgh equipment failed. It was on this original transmitter that Dr. Conrad had first experimented 4 years earlier. Conrad's wife recalls.
A few wires wrapped around a piece of pipe. I couldn't believe it. You looked at that thing and it talked back to you.
The real start of KDK was due to the fact that some of the department stores in Pittsburgh begin to advertise radio sets, which would receive signals that came from my laboratory.
It was 1919 when Conrad, bored with transmitting his voice, first sent music into the air.
The music will be from a Victrola pulled up close to the wireless transmitter.
Soon, Conrad exhausted his supply of Victrola records. He arranged with the Hamilton Music Store of Wilkinsburg to supply records in exchange for announcements of the store's name. Thus, the Hamilton Music Store became the world's first radio advertiser. H.P. Davis, Westinghouse vice president, soon realized that a real radio industry lay in the manufacture of home receivers, and regular radio programs would make people want to own such receivers. Thus, a license was secured, and election night, 1920, was selected for the first regular broadcast.
Some 30 million Americans are electing a president of the United States, a vice president, 34 United States...
Senators. After that first broadcast, there were many other KDKA firsts to come.
So you can watch the whole one-hour video at your leisure. So basically... The date that most people choose to honor is the November 2nd, which is election night when they did these broadcasts. But as I said before, Frank Collins had actually been experimenting for 4 years before that. And the first time he really sent out music was in 1919. So a full year before that, he was broadcasting music out. I have a little short video here that talks about the whole idea of the concept of radio broadcasting and how it ties in with the end of World War I and how it ties in with the whole idea post-pandemic of the 1918 flu pandemic. This is audio from the Radio Lab radio show from WNYC.
Where would you like to launch in?
Let's start in the fall of 1919. The war is over, the flu is winding down, and we're in Pittsburgh with this guy,
Frank Conrad, who had been a ham operator before the war. And once the war ends, in his garage, he, sets up his, or resets up his amateur station.
So that's Susan Douglas, radio historian.
And I am a professor of communication and media at the University of Michigan.
And back then, radio broadcasts were really just Morse code, just a bunch of beeps, boops. But Frank was about to change that.
He worked for Westinghouse, which was an electrical manufacturing company. So he thus had access to vacuum tubes that were used for transmission.
And all you need to know about vacuum tubes is that they were the secret bit of technology that let radio go from this to this thing that's full of life. But also, in that moment in history, in the wake of the flu, weirdly made us confront death.
Absolutely.
So on October 17th, 1919, Frank is in his garage with these fancy vacuum tubes. And then he picks up a microphone.
Pushed up to a phonograph.
And music floated out of Frank's little garage into the air. There's no recording of this broadcast. All we know is that Frank talked a little, played some music, and about 35 miles away, all the way across Pittsburgh, those sounds reached the ears of a little boy named Harry Mills.
I remember it was 10 or 11 o'clock at night, and all at once this voice appears. And I remember letting out a yelp or shout of some sort, and my dad, who had just gotten out of the bath, come in wrapped in a towel to be sure I was all right. Something hadn't happened to me. And I said, "Dad, look, I'm hearing this fella talking." And we shared the headphones. We only had one pair of headphones. And he allowed as I was right.
What a moment that must have been.
Can you, right?
Like, suddenly, like...
Imagine that's never happened before. You didn't realize that the radio could even do that. Yeah. And then his voice like fills your bedroom. I think that's just the coolest thing ever.
It's super cool.
And other people thought it was pretty cool too.
One of the Pittsburgh newspapers began reporting on this.
And once word literally got out
that it was this guy broadcasting a voice and music from his garage in Pittsburgh.
Soon all of these places,
America needs a tidal wave of the old time religion.
Religious organizations,
union makes us strong.
Labor unions
wanted to do what Frank did in his garage.
In the Rose Bowl, Michigan lives up to it.
Colleges and universities,
newspapers, the Boy Scouts.
Everybody wanted in on this.
And at this moment, the radio you'd have in your home is really just a bunch of coils and wires.
And a crystal. There was this little wire, and it was called a cat whisker.
Wow.
And you would basically move it around the crystal until you got something.
And in came the world.
People have been asking me for the last 2 days, why put a ventriloquist on the air? The answer is, why not?
And
we'd appreciate it if anyone hearing this broadcast would communicate with us.
As you'd move the whisker around that crystal,
you were not just hearing voice and music. You were hearing howls. You were hearing screeches. You were hearing static. All of this kind of atmospheric noise that was...
Go ahead, please.
Really creepy and really weird, you know?
You heard all of these sounds that lived between the voices, between the everyday human world and something that stretched beyond it.
And let's remember the context. By the end of World War I, between 10 and 20 million people had been killed.
And then another 50 million or so were killed by the flu. Pretty much everybody knew somebody who had died, a friend or a family member or a loved one, and they were
desperate for some kind of way of coping.
And so when people heard these mysterious voices on the radio,
hello, hello there,
a lot of them wondered,
is somebody trying to reach me? Are they okay on the other side? Is there another side? Can I communicate with the undead?
Susan says this was a real moment where spiritualism took off.
Ouija boards were flying off the shelves. People did go to seances.
People thought maybe my brother or mother or cousin or whoever else I lost was out there floating around in this space called the ether, which is also where people believed the radio waves lived.
And so explorations of the ether, you know, via radio might be the way in which we could connect with the dead.
So as broadcasting became more and more popular, as they said earlier, a lot of companies wanted to have their own radio station. And this is a list of the first 100 radio stations in the U.S. You'll notice that the first three were owned by Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing. The fourth one was RCA. And you'll notice down the line, you can see both news organizations, technology organizations, and some locations, some organizations like churches and steamship companies, and a variety of different things, printing companies. So you can see the first 100 stations licensed in the U.S. And that happened in less than 2 years of time. And it happened all around the country. Even though these first ones were in the East, you very quickly got stations in California. And then in the middle of the country in Omaha. So this is a two sections available for you to listen to. This is the first 50 years of radio history, and I'll just start one playing real quickly here for a little bit.
We harbor no fears.
We have no sordid ends to serve.
November the 2nd, 1920.
Contemplate or apprehend no conquest.
On that day, Warren G. Harding was elected president. And on the same day, something calling itself Station KDKA in Pittsburgh began a schedule of radio broadcasting starting with election returns that has never been interrupted. This album,
Franklin Roosevelt made that speech.
So these are both about a half an hour long for you to listen to. What I have here is a website called oldradio.com, and it has what's called the broadcast archive, and there's a lot of information on radio history. There's a lot of information on the people that were on radio, the types of things that were on radio, and there's also collections of radio equipment. This page is the National Museum of Broadcasting, and I have to add another word. It's proposed. It's really never taken off. This website's been around for a while, but they've never really did this. This was the garage at Frank's house, and they disassembled this for future reassembly in a museum, and it still remains in storage. It's never been reassembled. So the whole idea was they wanted to have this at the National Museum of Broadcasting in Pittsburgh, but it's never really been developed. So the 1920s, let's just listen in a little bit of this presentation.
Radio station was made by more and more popular. Before long, radio was the one device that every family just had to have. Manufacturers struggled to keep up with the growing demand. By 1922, radio sales were estimated at $60 million a year, and there were already more than 500 radio stations across the country. Very few other technologies have been adopted by the public as quickly as radio. Radios came in all shapes and sizes, too. The smallest and least expensive could be purchased for as little as $8. The most expensive units were well over $300. That would be more than $4,000 in today's currency. As radio became more commonplace, programming became more diversified. Before long, news broadcasts, weather reports, popular music, classical music, opera, sports, and fictional programming could all be found. Fictional radio programs became the most popular, especially in the latter part of the 1920s and into the 1930s. Similar to today's television programming, a variety of different genres appealed to a wide array of tastes. Westerns, mysteries, comedies, romance, and children's shows were all popular. Radio drastically changed American home life. Families would come home in the evening and gather around the radio to listen to the latest news and their favorite radio programs. Very similar to how families might watch television today. Some would even have radio parties, inviting over friends or families who might not have a radio yet. For the first time, a national culture began to develop. Listeners across the nation were enjoying the same music and laughing to the same comedy sketches. Baseball fans in Kentucky could listen to a game being played in Boston, while teenagers in Texas might be listening to the latest jazz music from the Cotton Club in New York City. At first, the federal government had very little regulation over the radio industry. As radio became more and more popular, the government eventually stepped in and began passing laws to monitor content and regulate other aspects of the industry. The Federal Radio Act of 1927 authorized the creation of the Federal Radio Commission, which oversaw radio. Not everyone was a fan of radio, though. Many derided the new technology as a mere toy. Others described it as virtually useless and saw no practical application for the device. The harshest critics suggested that it would cause a moral corruption of society as Americans became lazy and desired only more entertainment. Still others felt that it made the dissemination of information too easy, and thus people would not value it as much. However, despite these criticisms, one thing was clear to all. For better or worse, radio had arrived, and it was here to stay.
My mother's mother, my grandmother, had a radio in the early 20s, and because the town she lived in, no one else had a radio, she was put the radio by the window at the front porch, so that when the family listened to the radio in their living room, friends and neighbors could come by and sit on the porch and listen to the radio outside the window. So she had a very popular porch during the 1920s. My grandmother always had the latest gadgets. I remember in the 1960s, she's the only person I know that had a microwave oven, back then known as a radar range. So during the 1930s, because of the Depression and some other things, radio became a very integral part of the lives of many of the people. And I'll let you guys listen to these recordings later on your own. This is a collection of what's called the Golden Age of Radio programs, and there's a ton of these out there. You can go out and listen to them. Some are in the form of YouTube videos. Some are in the form of downloadable recordings, and you can listen to all these different things, and there's a wide variety of them available. There's also a large amount of jazz and swing and big band era music available, so let's just quickly play something here. I have some links for information on old-time radios, antique radios themselves, and some virtual museums available. And again, these are all links you can click on and go to them. This is a link that has some radio commercials from all the way 1950s through the 1960s. And this is an hour and 10 minutes worth of commercials. Dr. Pepper is
the drink to from a bestseller by the man who uncovered the unholy truth behind the kings of crime and their reign of terror.
For those who think young.
When you're out shopping or on your way home from the movies, stop in at a fountain. It's an American institution. And at fountains everywhere, now it's Pepsi. PepsiCo.
Famous simply because it tastes so good. The Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company, Milwaukee and other cities.
Steadier than any car in its class. Drive the 64 Fairlane, the family car with a sports car feel.
It's a Kent. The taste of Kent.
With songs performed by Simon and Garfunkel.
The family car with a sports car feel. Test drive a 64 Falcon.
And cold. Stroll's 12 can stay cold pack. Because
so I'll get to let you enjoy those radio commercials on your own at another time. And PBS did a series a few years back. Ken Burns, the same gentleman that did the Civil War series, on the Empire of the Air, and it's the radios, the men who made radio. And there's resources from the movie that you can go through. And you can read about and go through all this different information. Also, I have a link here so you can watch the movie. And you can watch the whole movie. Now, one of the interesting things is a lot of references to the spirit of radio in song and music. So I'm just going to play a couple of these quickly here.
Hey,
on our listeners chaos in Los Angeles. Let's go to the telephones now. And,
oh, nobody can see it right now. I had it on when he's... None of us are visible right now. Ah, you can turn it off for now. He's playing his excerpts of songs that mention radio.
Cruising at 7, push button heaven, capturing memories from afar.
Put your hands on the radio. I say, baby, you got the old wolf man, and he gonna give you all the thrills and spills that rock and roll builds. Hallelujah. Yes, indeed. Like this here one. It's Joe Walsh. Yes, it's Joe Walsh. And I want to tell you something. You hang on right now, because he's gonna be here for your personal enjoyment. It ain't gonna take long. It's called The Radio Song.
With God, turn your radio to be so good.
mention I'm a little bit corny. I'm a wildflower waving for you. Broadcasting tower waving for you. And I'm sending out this signal here. Hope you can pick it up loud and clear.
And that's the program. The addendum at the end of it is about amateur radio operators. I've included this for people that might be viewing this, but you know all about this. So that's the end of our program for tonight.